Our next Dirac medalist was recognized for her pioneering contributions to the quest for a unified theory of the strong, weak, and electromagnetic interactions, including the estimate of the natural scale of unification and insights about CP conservation in strong interactions. So, ladies and gentlemen, Dirac Medal recipient for year 2000, Professor Helen Quinn.
Thank you. I think Roman's remark that there are very few Dirac medals for work that has experimental confirmation is a good introduction to the reason I'm giving the talk I'm giving, which is about the questions that remain even 35 years later, because there are no experimental confirmations of this work, and the question about why that is and whether how we think about physics in that context. I think there's another beautiful point made in Roman's talk, which is that when you do mathematical physics, often it finishes up having applications in quite different places from the work that was the motivator for the original work. So the area that was the motivator for the original work. I'm not sure what that has to do with grand unification, however. Okay, so let's talk about trying to find patterns in the parameters of a gauge theory. And whether or not this is a productive operation is what this is really a talk for the students. It's not a technical talk for the people who are experts in the subject, so I hope you will forgive its simplicity. Okay, there are many, many scales in particle physics. We have symmetry breaking scales. We have varieties of coupling constants. We have quark masses, which have apparently unintelligible patterns, but certainly a huge range of scales. Same thing with lepton masses. Neutrino masses bring in another set of scales because there's a Majorana mass can be put into the problem. And that gives us another freedom of parameters. There's the question of why is CP violation in the strong interactions so weak compared to CP violation in the weak interactions, which is apparently maximal. And all of these questions about parameters invite us to try and find patterns, to try and find ways to organize the information more simply. And that's one of the quests as we go through particle physics theory, is to find explanations for the parameters. Sometimes we succeed, sometimes we don't. But it's part of what we're trying to do is say, can we build a theory that explains everything with fewer parameters? And that indeed was one of the motivations of grand unified theory. So let's talk about the gauge couplings. If you look at how we see physics, we see strong interactions, weak interactions, and electromagnetic interactions as three quite separate phenomena with three quite separate rates. Weinberg and Salam theory, which is Glashow-Weinberg-Salam, unification of weak and electromagnetic, is not really a unification. Right, it's an SU2 cross U1 theory that mixes up weak and electromagnetic, but it still has two coupling constants. And so we have three independent coupling constants, one for the strong interactions, one for the SU2, and one for the U1, and they seem to be sort of randomly related numbers. However, when you look, and Patti and Salam were perhaps the first people to do this, and when I go to Patti's talk, I'll tell you more about that history. When you try and put together the pieces, the quarks and the leptons, you see a pattern which almost begs to be put together in a unified theory. And Georgi and Glashow found a very simple unified theory, SU5, which all the quarks and all the leptons seem to fit into very neatly. So we asked ourselves the question, okay, if you have a unified theory, there's only one coupling constant. And how can you have one coupling constant, which turns out to have three very different values in all the experiments we do? The answer, of course, is that coupling constants evolve as you change energy. And when you ask how do the coupling constants of the SU3, the SU2, and the U1 evolve. They evolve differently. And so we looked and found that indeed they merged to a single coupling. Given the numbers that we had back then, 35 years ago, it seemed they merged pretty well to a single value, but at a very high scale. So this logarithmic evolution of the coupling constant, even though they're only different by an order of magnitude or so, gave you a merging at a symmetry breaking scale very much different from the symmetry breaking scale of SU2 cross U1. In fact, roughly 14 orders of magnitude different, even maybe in our original estimates more than that. And the idea that you can make an extrapolation over 14 orders of magnitude and not have any new physics intervene between now and then is actually quite a crazy idea. But it seemed to work. So grand unified theories have been kind of the basis of the thinking about particle physics ever since. But this introduction of this very high scale brings with it some problems. As I say, there's the good part, the bad part, and the ugly part of this extrapolation. The good part is that if you write this grand unified theory, there are additional gauge bosons which mediate proton decay. Now, we know that the proton half-life is long, so those additional gauge bosons had better be very heavy. And so we were very happy in the original calculation that we found those additional gauge bosons have a very high mass. In fact, we now know with further experiments on proton decay that the simple SU5 theory predicts proton decay at a level which is ruled out by experiment. So the simplest version of SU5 is experimentally ruled out. However, there are more complicated grand unified theories that you can write which are still perfectly acceptable with this result. Going to the next thing, the first thing that I think is bad about this is indeed the incredible extrapolation, because it means that any new physics at intermediate scales can change the result. And if the coupling constants don't quite meet, you can put something else in between 100 GeV and 10 to the 16th GeV that changes the way the coupling constants evolve and make them meet. So the fact that they don't meet is an indication that there probably is not a desert of no new physics from 100 GeV to 10 to the 16th GeV, but some other physics that intervenes at some intermediate scale. The second bad result is that if these two symmetry breaking scales, if the symmetry breaking works by scalar field theories, which is the simplest way we know how to make symmetry breaking happen in a gauge field theory, it requires something which is called technically unnatural. What does it mean that if something is unnatural? Keeping those two scales so far apart doesn't happen easily. When you allow the parameters in the theory to vary just a little bit, the heavy scale drags the light scale up towards it. So keeping those two scales apart requires what's called fine-tuning, a very careful adjustment of parameters so that at the low scale, you can maintain that low scale physics. Now, the question I pose, because a lot of theoretical work is based on fixing this problem, the question I would pose is this really a problem? The reason I'm not sure it's a problem is that the very formulation of the problem is perturbation theoretic. It's talking about how we calculate parameters and how we calculate how the parameters change with scale in perturbation theory. But of course, nature does not do perturbation theory. So the fact that there's a particularly fine adjustment of parameters is perhaps a suggestion, but it's not a demand that we have to solve the problem. So this is the challenge. Do we have to solve this problem or not? I don't know. However, I do know that supersymmetry is a possible answer to both these problems, right? If you add supersymmetry into the theory, it resolves the first problem by adding some things at intermediate scales that make the coupling constants come together very nicely. And it maybe resolves the second problem, because it, because of the supersymmetry, the evolution of the coupling constants is changed by the balancing of the fermion corrections and the boson corrections. And so keeping those two scales apart is easier in a supersymmetric theory than it is in a non-supersymmetric theory. However, supersymmetry is broken. And once it's broken, the problem reappears depending on the mass of the supersymmetric partner particles, how badly broken is supersymmetry. And because experiment keeps pushing the limit on the mass of the superpartners up, this resolution of the problem is not today such an obvious resolution. So the question, again, to think open-mindedly about what might be discovered at the next accelerator, this argued discussion all suggests there's some intermediate scale physics. Supersymmetry is a very nice option for what might be discovered, but it's not the only option. And so interpreting data, one has to keep an open mind about whether the new data indicating some new particles at intermediate scales, everybody will try to interpret it in terms of their favorite supersymmetric theory, but there should also be some thought about whether it's really fitting supersymmetry or it's just some other additional particles that aren't actually superpartners of anything that we already know. It'll be a difficult question to resolve. And so the question, my skepticism says you have to be very careful about saying you found the superpartners, but you have to really figure out that they are superpartners to something. Okay, the ugly, I've also mentioned already, it's that this unification scale brings us to thinking about physics at a scale where we cannot do experiment. And if we can't do experiment, we can never really be sure that our results, our physics is right. And furthermore, it's a scale where gravity comes into the picture, where we're talking about unification, but only of strong electromagnetic and weak interactions. By the time we get to this scale, we have to add gravity, because at the energies where the coupling constants come together, gravitational effects are as big as weak and electromagnetic effects, or nearly as big. So we have to start thinking about how do we put gravity in. And of course, that's taken physics in new directions, exciting directions. String theory offers a resolution which brings gravity in there. And it's very exciting and beautiful physics. But the problem is, how do you test it? And I think one of the exciting things about the talk Shiraz gave us yesterday, and it's again another version of what I mentioned with Rahman, some beautiful mathematical work was done trying to answer this question about how do you unify gravity with the other interactions. And string theory has produced a result which has nothing to do with the particle physics questions, but has to do with fluid dynamics. That's quite amazing, but I think it's when we as physicists investigate new mathematical formalisms, just as Dirac gave us all kinds of new and interesting physics, which Dirac certainly hadn't imagined before he wrote that equation. So every time we build new mathematical tools, it turns out there are physical realizations of them, but not always the ones we expected.